All right, thanks. Okay, so I want to start by talking about Gaussian elimination. Right, so we sort of all know what this is. And the reason I want to talk about it is like, you know, a very fundamental algorithm in linear algebra. But I want to say that in some sense, we still don't perfectly understand everything about it. And let me tell you what we don't understand. But tell you what we don't understand, I need to tell you what it is. Okay, so what it is to me is the following. You have a tall and skinny matrix. So this will be an n by r matrix. And I'm going to call it n. Okay, and so what is Gaussian elimination? There's many things you can put into like row reduced echelon form or whatever. To me, what I want to focus on is the following process. You take this m, and then you do some computation. And what do you get out of this computation? You get a smaller matrix, which is, say, you know, s by r. And this is m restricted to some, let's call this r prime. This is m restricted to some set s. So s is a subset of the rows, right? So basically, what we're going to do is we're going to pick out some subset of the rows. And what is the property that we want? We want that the row span of m is equal to the row span of m on these rows. Okay. And this is, to me, in some sense, is most often when you're using Gaussian elimination, all you're really doing. Okay. I mean, sometimes you need more. But what I want to point out is that there's some idea that this computation is very data dependent. Right. You really have to look at this matrix to figure out what is this set S. In a lot of situations, having data dependence in computation is annoying for one reason or the other, which is hard to motivate, and I won't really do that here. But I want to more ask a philosophical question. You know, can you do Gaussian elimination in a non-data dependent way? So what I mean by that, in some sense, is can you do Gaussian elimination without seeing the matrix? And this is sort of, you know, one of those undefined questions, like what is the sound of one hand clapping or something. But I want to say that there is actually an answer to this. And the answer, in some sense, is randomness. Okay, so what you could say is what is Gaussian elimination in this context is maybe just finding this subset. And you can easily convince yourself that, you know, there's no way for you to find the subset without seeing the matrix, unless you're allowing yourself exponentially many subsets. But there is some variant of this procedure that you can do that with some randomness and makes everything sort of work. Okay, and so
why do you call this? Usually you change the lines.
Change what? Okay, that's true. Yeah, yeah, okay, that's true, yes. Okay, I wanted to, yeah, okay, that's true. I don't personally, but I mean, yeah, so usually, I mean, the main feature that's important is that r prime is much less than your starting point. And ideally, you know, r prime is less than r, and even more ideally, it's equal to the rank or something. Yeah, but not really crucial, I suppose. So let me tell you like what I actually want. So the more general setup is the following. So you have, you know, an r by n by r by n, and then you're gonna, if you multiply these matrices out, you get an r by r matrix, which we'll call to be en. Okay, and so yeah, I mean you can do arbitrary row operations. You don't need to just select sets and so on. But if you're doing arbitrary row operations, what you can do is you can do random row operations, right? And it's not too hard to see that if you take a random e, what's going to happen, right? You're going to get what you want. You're going to get that the row span of em is equal to the row span of m, at least with high probability. Okay, and I want to say that this process is a little bit more data independent. Right, because picking E, you just picked it randomly and you did the matrix multiplication. I mean, you have to do something with respect to M. But the sort of the idea that, you know, you're not really looking at M to choose E in any way. Okay. But what's the problem with this? Like, why are we not doing this always? The problem is that we're using too much randomness. And I want to be randomness efficient. Okay. So what's the first of, yeah. So in some sense, whenever I talk or I give talks, there's always a field in the background, something like this field or something, right? But I'll tell you more about the field a little bit later. Whatever field you're comfortable with, in some sense, is the answer I want to give now. But maybe like the complex numbers, I don't know.
The questions make sense for every field. The answers reduce to the realistic that
I guess that's a way, a better way to say it. Okay, so, what is the first of, I think, at least four definitions, which hopefully won't be too much. Okay, so I'm going to take T by N matrices. I'm going to take some subset. I'm going to call it curly E. And I want to have some property out of this. Okay, and it's going to be a rank condenser if what? Well, basically, I want this property to hold for every M. Okay, so if you have M, which is R by N, let's say I'm promising you it's rank R, that for any M of this form, there's some, you know, E in this collection, curly E, such that what I'll promise now is that the rank is equal to. The rank is preserved. So here I was talking about the row span being preserved, but it's not too hard to see that these are the same thing. Okay. Okay, so this is what I'm going to call a rank condenser. And why am I calling it a rank condenser? Okay, that's always good to ask. Well, first of all, there's, you know, rank and I'm condensing the rank because this rank is being preserved. But what's really being condensed? Well, here's the picture. Right, so this. Yeah, I'll get there. I mean, I'll still call it a condenser, it would just be sort of stupid. Okay, so what is the picture? This circle is f to the n. And what you have here is you have the column span of m. Right, so that's this box, some linear subspace. And what is these matrices doing? They're taking you from f to the n to f to the t. And you know, the column span of m is going to go to the column span of em. Okay? And what you want is you want that basically this, you know, linear subspace is in some sense preserved. I mean, there's many things you could ask. What I'm asking is that the rank is being preserved. And ideally, you know, t is less than n, as Avi is saying, because you want to condense the ambient space. So this is an instance of dimension reduction. There's a lot of times in computation you find dimension reduction is very helpful, either it makes things faster or whatever. And this is you know, some version of this. OK. Right, so you know, there are a lot of parameters. And please ask me if there are any confusion. But basically, you know, n is the input dimension, t is the output dimension, and you're preserving rank R subspaces in this case. That's two lemmas away. Okay, but right. Well, I'll get to it. Okay, but the thing I wanted to do that, but before that, these two lemmas, is that the reason that, in particular, using the word condenser is because this is following a long line of work of pseudorandomness and other and dimension reduction in other situations, where you're not preserving necessarily rank, but you're preserving things like sizes of subsets or min-entropy. For those of you who know about that. You can sort of draw the parallels yourself. I won't actually talk about it. Okay. So this is a definition. What do we know about what exists and what doesn't exist in terms of these parameters? Right. So there's different questions of modeling. I will stick to there exists some E in the set. As you'll sort of see later, you can always push these to high probability statements. Without any real more work. Okay. Okay. So the first lemma is what do we know non-constructively? Well, let's do obvious comment first. Okay. So what do we know in terms of explicit constructions? And what is the most obvious explicit construction? Is that you basically take, you sort of de-randomize this random approach. Basically, you sort of iterate over basically all matrices. And if it's an infinite field, you can just take sort of some cube, and it's not really a big deal. But basically, there is an explicit set E of exponential size. So if you just iterate over all matrices, you'll get one of these objects. But the point is that, you know, I want something which is much smaller in terms of the size of this set. And the set is really quantifying how randomness efficient am I being in this process. Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. Right. Okay, so what do we know non-constructively? Well, it exists as long as the size of this set is this funny quantity. It's n times r divided by t minus r plus 1. Okay, so this is going to appear a couple times, so I might as well sort of explain it. Right? You can say, first of all, like how many matrices are there really of this form? Well, intuitively, how many parameters are there? There's n times r. Now, you can do a little bit smaller, but I'm going to ignore that. Okay, so this n times r is coming out because of counting the number of matrices. Okay, what is this t minus r plus 1? And why am I really fudging over this plus 1? Okay, I'm really keeping this plus 1 here because you can actually keep t equal to r. What that's saying is that when you're doing this dimension reduction, the output size could actually equal the rank you're preserving. Okay, and if I ignore that plus 1, you get infinity and so on. Right? But t being greater than r sometimes is nice because you actually get fewer maps. Right? Okay, so you know this is sort of the trivial thing. This is non-constructive. What do we know constructively? Okay, so these things have been considered in the past. And so there's this theorem of Ariel and Ron. And what they get is they get n times r squared. Okay, so they construct some rank condenser where the number of maps is n times r squared, which is already very nice, getting from exponential down to polynomial. Okay. Sorry? This one? Oh, no, I guess. So in this construction, and I guess most of the, actually all of the constructions that we have, the field you'll need is something polynomially large. So it won't work over F2, although we know that over F2 this concept does exist and exists roughly with these parameters. But it also works over the complex numbers. Basically, what you need is you need some sort of something like Reed-Solomon. You need some element of large enough multiplicative order. And that'll be a recurring theme. All the constructions I'm going to give will have this requirement. Although, so the main open question actually for me is, how do you get these sort of things when you have F2? Because it exists, but we don't know how to do it. OK. OK, so there's a work due to Amir Shpilka and myself where, for other reasons, we were considering these objects. And we just happened to notice that you can actually improve this construction to get n times r. Okay, which is not a really dramatic instance, but you can actually show. So this is when, this is when t is equal to r in this very special case. And when you notice when t is equal to r, this denominator becomes 1, and this is really n times r. So one of the things that was nice was that this was actually basically optimal, okay, at least in this case. And then there's this nice paper of Guruswami and Kopparty where they are actually getting n times r over t minus r plus 1. Again, under the same field restriction. OK, so I define some object which answers this question. And I'm saying there's already explicit constructions that meet this bound. So why am I giving this talk? What I want to say is that, aside from the fact that this is being optimal, what is the qualitative difference between, say, this nr squared and this bound? Because it sort of, maybe it doesn't really seem what's obviously more interesting. And what I want to tell you today is that this bound, and actually refinements of this bound, are actually very important for getting qualitative constructions of this object called dimension expanders, which I haven't defined, I'll do now. But basically, if you used these two results, even when t is greater than r or whatever, you wouldn't get anything. But you really need sort of the analysis of this paper to construct these objects. OK, so let me tell you now what dimension expanders. OK, so to me, dimension expanders are sort of another object in what to me is an emerging theory of pseudorandomness, where you're dealing with rank as opposed to sizes of subsets. Right, so this rank condenser was all about sort of condensing the ambient space while preserving the rank that you have. Dimension expanders is basically about maybe, say, keeping the dimension of the space the same while you're getting more rank. Okay, so what is that definition? So this definition is due to Barak, Impagliazzo, Shpilka, and Wigderson. And I guess, obviously, since you're here, I can ask you on the record, why did you define this?
Just
OK.
And then we found about the subproduct theorem, and we could
Okay. All right. Now it's on the record. Okay. So. No. It's definitely definitely a nice thing. Okay. Okay. The construction is as follows. You have n by n matrices. You're going to pick d of them. D will be the degree, as sort of always, right? And what do you want out of this? Well, the picture will be the following. You're going to have f to the n. You have f to the n. Okay. And you have d maps from f to the n to f to the n. So something like this. So this is a1, a2, dot, 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 up to ad. And what's going to be sort of the input to these maps is going to be some linear subspace as before. But now, since you have d maps, you're going to get d linear subspaces, right? So you're going to get d subspaces here. And you get, if you have d subspaces, the question is, you know, did they grow when you sort of took all these subspaces together? You know, does the rank increase? Well, you want to say that, yeah, the rank increases by some way, or the dimension increases. So basically, you're saying you have some subspace. Let's say the dimension of V is at most epsilon n. We want to say that this is a dimension expander if the dimension of the span of these images, AIs of Vs, is at least alpha times the dimension of V. And this will be a epsilon alpha dimension expander. Yeah, I mean, otherwise it's sort of trivial. Yeah. So, yeah. I don't know, is alpha usually, I mean, to me, it's okay, so what are the parameters here? Okay, so yeah, the first observation is that alpha is at most d, right? Because you have d maps, and so alpha is clearly at most d. You know, ideally, you know, one would hope that alpha is greater than 1. It's sort of, otherwise, it's sort of silly. For this talk, so you start with something with epsilon n, and then you multiply by alpha. So and the dimension certainly can't go above n, right? So epsilon is n is certainly most 1. And in this talk, most of the time, you'll have epsilon n to sort of be bounded away from 1. So this will be something like bounded away from 1. Otherwise, it's not going to get much. So epsilon is the size, the size of your subset. So epsilon n is the size of your rank. Okay. And okay, but what do say random constructions give you? Okay. So it depends on basically in combinatorics, right? You might have a bipartite graph, and when you have a bipartite graph, and you have edges between them, and you may have, say, a deregular bipartite graph. And the question is, in a vertex expander, for example, bipartite, you have a set on the left side, and you take all of the images of that on the right side. And the question is, does the size of that set increase? Does it expand? Okay, so this is basically some analog of a bipartite vertex expander, where you're replacing the size of the set with rank. And you can actually say a little bit more precisely about like the Cayley graph of these things or something, and that more formally, but that's the level of the analogy. Well, I think it's also, I mean, that was also weaker in what, okay, I'll think about that later. But anyways, okay, so suppose that you take, I introduced these parameters, I want to tell you what you can get in terms of these things. If you take random matrices, then it will be a epsilon alpha expander if what? If D is at least alpha plus 1 over 1 minus epsilon alpha. Okay, I'm giving this to you because later on I'll compare some parameters. But basically, what is this saying? Right, alpha is the expansion. It's always at most d. That's at most what you could hope for. And what is this parameter? Right, epsilon alpha is the output size of your expansion. And we know it's at most 1, but that's why I'm giving this restriction that is bounded away from 1. And so if epsilon alpha is at most 1/2 or something, then this is 2. Right, so then the degree is the expansion plus 2, or plus, you know, alpha expansion plus 1 plus some constant or something. Okay? And so ideally, you know, we could meet this, but the weaker challenge, you know, raised by these four authors, is just to get something where all of the things are constant. Right? So you want subsets which are of constant or rank dimensions, subspaces which are of constant size. You want expansion 1 plus some constant. So you want expanders of this form where the degree is constant. Right? You know, ideally maybe you could match this, 50 years from now or something, but the first step is due to something like this. Okay? And so what do we know about this? Well, it'll sort of be something like this, where I'm going to give you a bunch of previous work and tell you they solved the problem. But I'm going to still tell you something interesting by the end of it. OK. So there's this paper by Lubotsky and Zelmanov, where they basically, they get this explicitly. Yeah. The restriction is that the characteristic of the field needs to be 0. And in particular, they establish a conjecture of Avi on expanding groups. Okay, so Avi, pointed out the connection between dimension expanders and regular expanders. And we know how to construct regular expanders. So a natural question is, can we use the ideas we had for constructing regular expanders to get these objects? In particular, you can take an expanding group. You can take a group, you can construct its Cayley graph, right? And we know that sometimes for special groups and special sets of generators, that Cayley graph will be an expanding graph, right? And if you think about it, you can kind of think of this Cayley graph as a regular representation of this group. And you can ask, well, what if we take other representations of this group? In particular, irreducible representations, right? Those are in some sense more linear algebraic. Are those dimension expanders? And Lubotsky and Zelmanov said, in characteristic 0, the answer is yes, or at least sometimes, or something. So basically, you take an expanding group, right, one that has like Kazdan property T. You take an irreducible representation of this group. And then you take some generators that generate the Cayley graph of that group, and you evaluate those generators in this representation. This will give you a bunch of matrices according to the size of that irreducible representation. And they're saying that that is a dimension expander. No, finite group. You take larger and larger groups. At least, something bigger than 0, bounded away from 0. Oh, it depends on the expansion of the group. There's a
exactly the same parameter.
Well, there's a divided by 12, right? It's like something. What? Okay. I don't particularly know, but But basically, the point is that this is a construction based on existing constructions of expanders. Okay, so Zev and Amir, they did another approach, which is something called a monotone expander, which I won't really define because it's not so important here, but basically it's a bipartite vertex expander where if you think about the edge relations, there's some monotonicity to them. And they observed that if you take a monotone expander, this will give you a dimension expander. So this is, a graph theoretic, combinatorial thing, and a dimension expander is linear algebraic. But they're saying that whenever you have this also, and you get something kind of special where, in fact, these matrices are always 0, 1. Okay, so it's actually a construction over, Boolean values. And as such, it'll actually work over every field. So this will be every F. So this is in some sense surprising because, you know, this result only works in characteristic 0, right? But here it's saying that you have a single construction which works everywhere. Okay. But of course, you need a monotone expander. What did they get? They got logarithmic degree using ideas from Cayley graphs on abelian groups. Zevanavi got, if I remember right, an iterated logarithm degree for any constant c. And they did this using some sort of iterative construction of monotone expanders. And then Borgain and Yehudayev got constant degree monotone expanders, and they're using expansion in this group SL2 over the reals. So the reason this comes up is, you know, you want some sort of monotone object, and monotonicity occurs if you have, you know, a totally ordered object, like the reals. Right, so basically, you take the reals, it's totally ordered, you look at this group, you get some sort of expansion, and then you discretize, and then you get what you want. Okay, so basically, this is saying that you can get constant degree dimension, you know, monotone expanders, and thus dimension expanders, over every field. Not to my knowledge. Right. Yeah. Right. So, like Lubatsky-Zelmanov, what they basically showed is what I think what Avi said. That going from special expansion, you also can get. If I'm. No. Okay, so you know, basically we have constructions, but what I want to do today is to give you a different construction.
Just to motivate your different construction, I should point out that very, very, very few people understand the book. It's extremely complex. The construction of monotone expanders would be great to get another construction of monotone expanders.
Yes.
You can understand. And moreover, another mysterious thing about the monotone expanders is
yeah, so that's sort of a weird state of affairs. But I think it's more powerful when you say it than when I say it. Because when I say I don't understand something, well, if I say I don't understand something, I mean, that doesn't mean much. Okay. So what is this work getting? So we get explicit, say epsilon, eta dimension expanders, and because we have nice parameters, or at least some nice, I'm going to compare them to the existential construction. Right, and so the degree will be something like 4 divided by epsilon 1 minus eta squared. Okay, so I mean, in these sorts of constructions, I mean, there's less focus on the, you know, the exact constants, and I mean, I certainly couldn't figure them out. So, but this is what we have. Okay, and you know, the comparison is that you could hope for something like 1 minus 1 over epsilon plus 1 minus 1 over eta. So we're sort of like quadratically away from this construction. Okay, but the point. Did I mess up? Yeah, I messed up. Okay. This is epsilon eta. Yeah. Okay. So what this construction will do, you know, so these things here are based on sort of conventional ideas on how to construct expanders. What I want to tell you here is this construction will be sort of looking at dimension expanders as inherently about linear algebra and rank. So there, you know, certainly when you talk about spectral graph theory, that is linear algebra. But that's linear algebra where you're inherently talking about eigenvalues and eigenvectors, and you're really dealing with the real numbers at some point. This construction will basically work over any field, at least if it's polynomial large, and we'll just really think about rank as rank.
Okay. So just to be concrete with these parameters,
And you can take epsilon, you can take epsilon eta as close to 1 as you want. Yeah. OK. I don't know one, but I wrote a paper on it, so somehow I still like them. Well, but. So I mean, these are sort of already have expanders built in. Yeah. My construction basically is all about Reed-Solomon codes, so probably not. I mean, if you go long enough, you walk far enough, you've got expanders doing anything, but or something. But the point is that I don't think what I can do will give you expanders. Okay, so basically, the proof idea will be very simple and in some sense conceptual, and it really just fell out of what we were doing. We didn't really intend to do this at all. An accident, but there's sort of two operations that's going to happen. So we're first going to do a tensor operation, which is in some sense a trivial form of expansion, okay? And then we're going to do a condensing operation, which will remove the condensing, the trivial aspect of the trivial expansion of tensoring. So let me tell you about tensoring, which is sort of simple anyways, but I'm going to belabor the point. Right, so suppose that you have, there exists a1 up to ad, and what are they going to do? They're going to take f to the n to f to the nd, and they're going to be sort of a 1d expander. So this is not really true, because in an expander, you need to have the input and output be the same size. But basically, I'm going to say that that's why it's a 1, every subspace will be expanded by factor d, right? And so what do these AIs look like? Basically, you know, we use the fact that f to the nd, right, this is just the tensor of f to the n and f to the d, right? And so what is AI going to do? Well, it's going to send some vector v to v tensor the ith standard vector. And just to labor it one more time, right, so if you have some vector v and say d is 2, what's going to happen? You're going to basically have two slots. And what's A1 going to do? A1 will put v in the first slot and 0 in the second slot. Right? And so I'm assuming that right. OK. So this is sort of like a very simple, trivial thing to do. So A2, we'll just put it in the second slot. So the 0 will go in sort of the first slot, and V will go in the second slot. This is the action of A2. There'll be D slots. There'll be D slots. And the ith operation will put V in the I slot. And so basically, you're getting just disjoint copies of your vector space. So it's sort of trivial that you get a dimension expansion of D. But the problem is that, you know, the output size is too much. OK, so now we need to fix that. And so the question is, how do we fix that? And your test taking skills should sort of tell you that I defined something, and we're going to use it. Right? So, OK, so the picture is as follows. You have f to the n, and you have a rank R subspace in it. And then you're going to do a tensoring operation, f to the nd. And this is going to be a degree d map, right? So this is the tensor operation. And what are you going to get? You're going to get rank r times d, right? And now, basically, we just need to fix the output size. So now we're going to map back to f to the n. And ideally, we get something like r times d. Okay. And what we need to do here is we need to use some sort of rank condenser. But the question is, what is the degree going to be? Okay. Well, let's just sort of do it out. In this case, the ambient dimension is n times d. The rank is r times d. And the output size is n. So it would be n minus r times d. And let's say that r times d is, say, at most n over 2. Okay. And so what is the degree you're going to get? Well, it's going to be something like d squared times r. About. And so that's sort of unsatisfying, right? Because, you know, d might be a constant, but r is certainly not a constant. So given this, it seems like, you know, I failed you or something, right? And so really, the point.
In this calculation, you're using the bounds.
Right.
And the
so I'm using. No, I'm using this.
Already this.
Yeah, so
it's
r. Still not good enough. So it's still not good enough. So what went wrong? And what went wrong is, in some sense, we're not using the strong enough definition. OK, so part of the contribution of this work is to give definitions of what we believe to be the right thing. In particular, if you look at, say, Guruswami and Kopparty, they don't actually talk about rank condensing at all. They talk about subspace designs. Basically, what we observe is that they're actually the same thing. And you can use their analysis to get which are better rank condensers in certain settings. OK, so basically, what's wrong here is that in this condensing framework, we really strove to exactly get rank RD. We didn't lose anything. But we could be a little bit more permissive, and we could lose half of the rank. What would that give us? So that would give us something better. And I want to define that for you now. So this is a lossy rank condenser. So we have the same setup. The input is size n. The output is t. It will be an R epsilon lossy rank condenser. If what? Right? We have, again, an m of n by r, say rank r. And we want that there's some e in curly e that preserves most of the rank. So that the rank of em is at least 1 minus epsilon times the rank of m. Okay. And so in this setup, what can you hope for? Right? Because before, I told you we already have optimal bounds. Maybe we can get something better. And indeed, you can. So the lemma is that this exists if what? If the size of your, if the number of maps you have is something like n over epsilon t minus r. And this is, again, by counting. OK, so let's figure out, like, is this enough for the application? So epsilon, so epsilon being 1 would mean you lose everything. So that's not so good. But if epsilon was 0, you get infinite. And I'm sort of abusing, there really should be some pluses, plus 1s here. And being, I mean, the way to think about this is that this is n times r divided by this factor, which is what we had before, divided by epsilon r plus 1. And so if you set epsilon to be 0, you get what you had before. But now you're dividing by something possibly larger than 1. Okay. And we'll see why you do this division shortly. OK. Doesn't go down. OK. So let's return to this picture and say, you know, so this is in the non-lossy case. But what about in the lossy case? you know, what sort of parameters do we get? Well, basically, now you have n times d times r times d. And now you're going to divide by, say, you know, rd over 2 or something. Right, so in this case, now you're dividing this number by rd over 2. And so this is going to be about d. Okay. So now this is saying that if you allow me to lose some of the rank, you can get a degree about d in this rank condensing. So in particular, I can put a degree about d here. Okay, and then the total degree will be about d squared. And so basically, you get the parameters that you want. There's a little bit more fudging you have to do, but that's the main idea. Okay, so basically, what I'm saying is that I'm sort of phrasing things in this sort of grand linear algebraic pseudorandomness vision, and this just sort of pops out. I mean, I think that's, to me, the nicest aspect of this. Okay. Right, so basically, in this particular regime, what you get is you get, you can get something like this. You're expanding dimension 1 over 2d. The expansion factor will be 1 minus delta times d. And the degree will be 2d squared over delta. Right, and now you just sort of take delta and d to be what you want. There are a couple details that I'm sort of omitting. So one annoying detail is that there's sort of rank equal to r versus rank less than r. So I think most people would not even really think about it to some extent, but it does act, I mean, because you want to expand all small enough subspaces, you really need to worry about this. And it is something that you have to do, but basically the constructions that I erased all handle this fine. So that's not a big deal. The problem is that the way I defined all of these notions, right, I'm saying if M has rank equal to R, and there's a concern that, you know, what about less than or equal to R? Things become a little bit weirder, because you have to deal with all small things at the same time. Because it could be that your construction depends on R. And if your construction depends on R, you need to do different constructions for different R, and that's a problem. But what I'm saying is that these constructions are a single construction which work for all R simultaneously. Okay. All right, that's one subtlety. The other subtlety is that this d that you're picking, the amount that you're tensoring, is always an integer. And so this is a particular problem for getting, say, 2/3 1 plus constant expansion. Right, so suppose you want to expand, you know, dimension 2/3 n. Right, well, if you do a tensoring operation, you sort of have gone beyond n, and there's some small technicalities there. This is just annoying, so I don't want to talk about it. But there's something there. Okay, so basically, this concludes the dimension expander part, saying, you know, we have this construction, assuming this lossy condenser here. Okay. Okay, so now I want to construct this lossy condenser for you, but to do that, you need another definition, which is a stronger object, which is this will fall out of. Okay, so I'm not sure we got the names right, but this will be a lossless rank condenser. Again, you'll have some ensemble of matrices of t by n matrices. This will be a lossless. This will be a R, L lossless rank condenser. And the difference here is the following. So let's look at this definition. Right? This is saying that there's some E in your ensemble which preserves most of the rank. Right? But it could be that for most of the E in your ensemble, they like lose everything. Right? They're just very forgetful. They lose it, everything. They don't know where it went. Right? We want to say here that, in fact, if you look at all of the loss over all of the E in your ensemble, it's not that big. Okay, so for any matrix M of the desired form, you have that the summation of your rank deficiencies. So this is the rank of M minus the rank of M minus the rank of EM. Right, so this is the rank deficiency, the amount that you lost by E. The sum here is at most L. Okay. So can you read this, Galat? I mean, you seem scared. Right. Right, so the point is that this is sort of an analog of saying that you have a low degree polynomial, and then the number of roots is finite. Right, so in this collection, that makes it sort of weird that the size of your ensemble could be infinite, or exponentially large, or whatever. But the total rank deficiency is still bounded. And the point is that the reason for that is that there's some polynomial there that's governing when this rank loss happens, and that has low degree. So the total number is bounded. Okay, and so, I wanted to say it at some point. Right. So here's the remark. So this is something we're calling a lossless condenser. Hopefully that will be the right name in 10 years from now. But if you look at what Venkat and Swastik did, they defined something called a strong subspace design. Okay, and these notions are equal. So I haven't defined that for you, but I'm not going to really. But the point is that these are the same object, but the emphasis on the parameters is very different. So here, we want a lossless rank condenser, and we want E to be sort of not that big, because we want it to be randomness efficient. But for them, they wanted E to be as large as possible, because in some sense, they're designing some code, and they want to have a large rate. So they want to design something which is very, very large, where we still have this small L. The list bound is still small. But here, we don't really care that it's large. We just want it to be L to be small, but the size of the ensemble to be maybe L plus 1. Okay. So it's just a different parameter regime. And this is not unfamiliar to the realm of pseudorandomness that you have these sorts of connections. OK, in terms of the expectation comment, basically, once you define this object and you think about it in terms of expectation, it's not too hard to see how you get a lossy condenser, right? So what is the formal statement? It's something, if you have an RL lossless, and this is really of any size, okay, then what can you get out of it? You can get an R epsilon lossy. And what is the size going to be? It's going to be L over epsilon R. Okay, but so a lossless rank condenser is saying you have any M of rank R, and the total rank deficiency is that you have when you do overall maps is L. And so how many of these rank deficiencies can really be large, right? In particular, how many of them can lose epsilon R rank, which is what you're concerned about here? And the answer is not too many, right? Because by an averaging argument, if this was at least epsilon R, then you can say you can do the bound, and you can get the number of maps that are bad are going to be this. And so really, you just have a plus one.
Yeah.
Right. Yes. Right. Right. So this object could be infinite, but then you take some finite set. Okay. Okay. So I think that's the last definition. And now I want to tell you what Swastik and Venkat did, what the construction was. At least what the parameters were. Yeah. Sorry? Yeah, I mean, pictorially, what helps me at least, something like this. You have something like this. And this is, for each map, you plot the rank deficiency. And the total area is at most L. And then you sort of chop it off. And then the point is, and so not too many, this is like the bad set. Here's epsilon R, something. And the point is that no matter where this bad set is, as long as you take something plus 1, you can't fill the entire thing. Okay. Okay, so what did Venkat and Swastik do? Right, so they said that suppose that you have a field which is polynomially large, then you're going to get an explicit set of maps. And what is it? The parameter is going to be, it's going to basically be what you want. It's going to be nr divided by t minus r plus 1, lossless ring condenser. Okay. And this will be actually for all r less than t simultaneously. So they're going to give some construction of maps. You know, it's going to map n-dimensional space to two-dimensional space. And for any rank that you want, the total rank deficiency will be this bound. Right? And this was the bound that we had before for the original notion of a rank condenser. This is the total bound. This is this L. No. This is the total rank deficiency. I haven't told you the size of this set. And I mean, you can take the size of the set as big as you want. I mean, okay. Their concern was taking it as big as you want. You can't get it exactly. They don't know how to push it exactly. But for us, it's going to be big enough to instantiate this lemma. Okay. And now I want to talk about the construction. And before that, I'll give you a quiz. So who knows what a Wronskian is? It's a Polish person, I believe, Wronski. And I think Wronskian is the mathematical object named after this person. Sorry? I'm going to explain it, but this is something which I can literally say you should all have learned in first year differential equations, because that's where I learned it. I totally forgot about it myself, so I would not. So I'm going to tell you why you should know it, just for culture. Okay. Okay. So consider the following differential equation as an example. The second derivative of y plus y is equal to 0. Okay. So what is ordinary differential equations? What does it teach you? Well, the first is that there's a two-dimensional solution space. Right, so this is a linear differential equation. So there should really be two independent solutions. Right, and if you sort of go to a freshman at the university, what are they going to tell you the solutions will be? Right, there'll be solution e to the ix, and there's also the solution e to the minus ix. Okay, and so it's like, look, I found two solutions. There's at most two-dimensional solutions. Maybe I'm done, right? And so what they make you do in these classes is they say, prove to me that you're done. In particular, prove to me that these are linearly independent. And how do you do that? Well, you can do something like this, right? So suppose there was a linear dependence, and this is as functions on the complex plane or something, right? So you have a times e to the ix plus b times e to the minus ix is equal to 0. And if you have this equation, right, this is a function on the complex plane, so then you can differentiate it. Right, and so you get the I and the minus I come down, minus I b e to the minus I x equals 0. And so now you have two functions and you have two equations on them. And if you sort of assemble this into a matrix, what do you get? Because now you have a linear relation on these vectors as functions. Right, so you have e to the minus I x, I this and minus I. Right, so this is a matrix, and the fact that these equations hold means that this, as a complex analytic function, has rank, it has determinant 0, for example. Okay, that's what that would mean if they're linearly dependent, right? If they're dependent, yes. Okay, but you can notice that the determinant is equal to minus 2 times I, which is not 0. Okay, so now you can generally certify that these, in fact, are different equations. And so what really went on here, this is why people study them. Um, So I'm saying, suppose they were linearly dependent, right? Then that means that such an equation holds, where A and B are not both zero, right? And now you can differentiate this equation because this is a differentiable function, and then you get this equation, right? And if you phrase these equations in matrix algebra, that's saying that there's some column dependence between this matrix. And if there's a column dependence, we know that it has determinant zero, but it does not. It has a non-zero determinant, right? Okay, so what's going on? You have n functions more generally, right? And what does the matrix look like? Well, you have fi, and then you take the derivative of fi, and then you take the n minus 1th derivative of fi. So each column is one column per function, and you just take the derivatives. Okay. And what this argument is basically saying, the easy direction of the argument is that if they're linearly dependent as functions, say on the complex plane, then the determinant of this matrix is equal to zero. Okay. And a harder thing is to say that if the FIs are, say, analytic functions, and the determinant is zero, right, then you can actually conclude that they're linearly dependent. So that seems interesting and okay. To this day, analytic functions still scare me or something. So I always care about polynomials. And so the question is, what happens when you have polynomials? And if you don't have analytic functions, then this is false. You can find counterexamples. Right. So this is. You have analytic functions that has to be over the complex numbers, right? And so, but what about finite fields, which are my friends? So we're going to restrict to polynomials. And what is the definition here? The definition is follows. It'll be the Wronskian map. It'll be parameterized by T and alpha. W is just for Wronskian. What's going to happen is you take a polynomial, f of x, it's going to be univariate, and you're going to map it to T evaluations. And the evaluations are going to be polynomials in alpha. Okay. So you have f of x. And what is the output? It's going to be f at alpha, f prime at alpha, up to the t minus 1th derivative at alpha. Right, so that's basically what you're doing here if you think of this matrix as acting on polynomials. Okay. And now, so far, I've not really been talking about polynomials. I've just been talking about vectors. You can say, well, what's the connection? The connection is basically that you're going to use the fact that you can think of low-degree polynomials of degree at most n, as just vectors. So you take a vector, and you think of it as a polynomial. Polynomial is a vector, and so on. And so that's basically, and if you think of these as vectors, right, this space is dimension n. This space is dimension t. Right, so this is exactly giving the map from n to t, as before. Alpha is just sort of a parameter that I'm thinking of. Okay. And so this is some map. Right, and what it did, Venkat and Swastik prove. So the way I'm thinking of it, so I'm sort of thinking of this as a generic element. Okay, so I'm sort of thinking as alpha is an element of the field, x is more like really a genuine indeterminate. But you'll see a little bit more carefully from this statement. Okay, so suppose that the characteristic of the field is at least n. What do they show? They say, suppose you pick a subset S from your field, and it can really be any size. Then if you take the t-th order Wronskian at alpha for all alpha in your set, then this is a R and R t minus R plus 1 lossless rank condenser. Because this Wronskian, I'm thinking it mostly as a map, but you can evaluate it as a matrix. And this is giving you what you want as long as the subset is big enough, which it can be arbitrarily large. OK, so this is the construction. Are there any, I'm going to go over it more, but are there any questions on this? So this is a map. This is a linear map from polynomials to evaluations. And it naturally defines a matrix, which I'll review a little bit more later. So S is just some subset of evaluation points. Yeah, so for every evaluation point, you get a different.
Any S is good.
Any S is good here, as long as it's big enough. I mean, the analogy is, again, with univariate polynomials. You know, there's some idea that if you have a low-degree univariate polynomial, it only has so many roots, so you can really take any evaluation points, and as long as you take enough, you'll find some non-zero of it. Yeah, but then it's trivial because this is like a list. This is the sum of the ranked efficiencies. And so if you have no,
the sum will be empty
in that case.
Okay, good.
Yeah. Okay, so I want to dwell on one small detail, which is the following remark. Is that so far I've been talking about fields which are polynomially large. And this theorem is about fields which have large characteristic, and that's sort of annoying. And the question is, can you fix this? And so a lot of people, including myself, would think that Hassel derivatives or whatever would be some technical way of fixing this. And here, Hassel derivatives don't work. So even if you use Hassel derivatives, if you don't know what those are, it doesn't really matter. But basically, it's some way of usually dealing with characteristic issues, and it doesn't work here. And so I'm just going to tell you how you fix it with an alternate construction, which they also consider, which. Right. So I want to define what they call to be the folded Wronskian. Okay. So I'm going to have some element gamma from my field. And what is the map going to do? It's going to take f of x to f of gamma alpha, f of gamma squared alpha, up to f of gamma to the t minus 1 times alpha. So this is the new map. And for those of you who know things about locally, like list decodable codes, this is sort of like folded Reed's element codes. And that's why they actually called them folded. This is called the folded Wronskian. Okay. And I think it's an interesting question, right? These are two different constructions, and the same parameters hold. So you get the same parameters as long as 1, gamma squared, up to gamma to the n minus 1 are distinct. So gamma is some field element you choose. And as long as the field is large enough, you can choose a gamma such that this is true. Okay. And once you've chosen such a gamma, this construction will work with the same parameters. So this is just saying that you can do this over any large field. And you can kind of see why you need a large field, right? You need the gamma here, and over there you need the characteristic. Okay. Sorry. No, here the characteristic could be 2, but the field would be at least large, at least polynomially large, so that you can support such an element gamma. Okay, now, to me at least, it's sort of interesting to ask, are these constructions really different? And because, they seem related, they have the same parameters and so on. And the remark is that they are the same, in quotes, in the sense that there's some notion that you're using a different notion of derivative. So here, in this construction, you use something called the gamma derivative, okay? And not really, you have to massage it a little bit, but there's some idea that there's a formal notion in which you can tie these things together and you can do a single analysis and everything works. But I won't do that for you because it's technical. But the point is that I'm saying that these are the same, although this is new. This Wronskian has been studied since the 1850s. This has been studied since 2013. So, No, that's definitely true. But the idea is that it's really about differentiation, which is interesting. No. I mean, we know that. Yeah, we know that non-constructively, by counting, right, there exist many linear maps.
No, I'm talking about
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. Right. That's true, yes. But I think, I mean, I guess the point is I don't know of any other, personally. It depends on the proof. So there are various proofs that these work, and some of them just use the fact. So I mean, I'll show you a proof that this is more or less correct. And if you look at that proof, you can say, oh, what's really going on is you have a Vandermonde matrix, and really what's going on is you have a code, you have Reed-Solomon. So to me, it's just saying that you have a code and it's fine. So you can actually construct this out of any MDS code. So I guess that kind of answers your question. Yeah. But there are other proofs. Which really use use more the special structure of what's going on here.
Of the derivative.
Of the derivative, yeah.
Structure apart from just being the medium.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Okay, so what I want to prove for you now is, or give you the proof due to myself and Amir. Not that this is a lossless condenser, but this is just a rank condenser of the first kind I defined for you. So what does that mean? So you have, consider the case where you have rank R and you're condensing to an R-dimensional space. You have some element gamma. You take, some subset S, and you evaluate this folded Wronskian at all of the alpha and S. And I want to say that this is an R, comma, zero, rank condensed, like lossy rank condenser. And you can, in particular, you can do this when S is at most n times R. Okay, so I'm saying that I have n times R linear maps that take n-dimensional space to R-dimensional space, such that one of these linear maps will always preserve exactly the rank. So there's actually no loss. I mean, lossy because that's how I define it, but the zero means that there's no loss. Okay. Okay, so this is what I want to prove for you. But let me tell you sort of more about this construction, at least in a way that helps me. So what is this map? So I'm going to change notation from W to E. So E alpha is just going to be the same thing as here. E alpha is a matrix. Right? It sends n-dimensional space to r-dimensional space. And it acts by this way, but I'm going to give you a more concrete description, which is as follows. In the ijth entry, what's going to be here is it's going to be gamma to the I, alpha to the j. And why is that? It's because the ith row is supposed to be the evaluation of the polynomial at gamma to the I alpha. And you're ranging over j, and this is just the evaluation, the moment curve. Okay. No. So Gabbett. Guruswami and Kopparty had a different matrix. Amir and I defined this matrix, and Venkat and Swastik realized what it really is, this folded Wronskian object. OK. So how do you prove that ranks are preserved? Right? There's a polynomial there, the determinant that's governing this. Right? In particular, we have this matrix E, E alpha. We have M, which is what we want to preserve, and we get E alpha M. Okay, this is N by R. This is R by N. What is the output? It's an R by R matrix. And what do we want? We want that the rank of E alpha is equal to the rank of M. Now, I'm sort of promising you always basically that the rank of M is R. So really, you just want this matrix to have determinant non-zero. If you want the determinant of E alpha, M is not zero. So you certainly want that to be true as a formal polynomial in alpha. And you also want this to be low degree. And so the degree is, in fact, at most r times n times r. It's like not too hard to show. It's actually a little bit less. But you basically, by inspection, you can see this degree bound. And so if this was a non-zero polynomial, because you have a low degree, you just take enough evaluation points, you'll find a non-zero evaluation. Right? So that will give you that for any set S, as long as it's large enough, it's fine. Sure. I might mess up, so you have to fix me. That's right. So that will complete this proof. And how do we do that? Yes. Okay. So there's this Cauchy-Binet formula, which tells you how to compute determinants of matrices that are formed of products like this. And let me remind you what the formula is. It's not really super important what the exact form is, but you can look it up on Wikipedia later. But the point is that suppose you have a fat and this matrix times this matrix of these forms. What does the determinant look like? Well, what you're going to do is it's going to be some sort of exponential sum. You're going to take some determinant, which is related to A, and multiply it by the determinant, which is related to B. And you're going to take a summation. And what is the summation over? You're going to take subsets of size R. And the subsets are going to be of this set N. Okay, so you have N choose R as many subsets. What is A restricted to S? Well, you're going to take a subset of the columns of A. This will be some set S. You're going to take an R by R matrix here. You take the correlated, right, because this is the same S in these both things, a subset of the rows of B, you get an R by R matrix. That's square, you can take it as a determinant. And then you just take this exponential sum. Right? It's worth thinking, like, what happens if N equals R? That's just saying the determinant is multiplicative. Right? So there's some generalization of that to arbitrary formats.
It's also a generalization of the case R equals 1, so you have another
order. I've never thought about that. But yes, that's okay. So we're gonna, you can use Cauchy-Binet to analyze this formula. And what does that look like? Right? So it's saying the determinant of EX of M, right, is equal to the determinant equals to this big summation of determinant of EX at S and determinant of M at S. Now, this is challenging to understand, right? Because there's some idea this is an exponentially large summation, and you need to show that this polynomial, this large summation is non-zero. And so what can we do? Well, first let's understand what we can. Let's understand this object. Well, but you need to show that there's no cancellation.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Right. So, the most naive thing is to say that here's a monomial that's non-zero. The challenge would be that maybe it's non-zero here, but it's minus non-zero over there, and then you get cancellation. What we'll see, and like I said, spoils the punchline, but is that there's actually a single monomial that's not canceled, so you look at this thing, it's not canceled, and so you know that the polynomial is non-zero. Yes. 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 Okay, so to understand the setup, so what is E alpha again? Well, I'm going to decompose it into two ways. Okay, let's decompose it into sort of the x, into the gamma part and the x part. Right, so here you have just gamma to the ij. Okay, and over here you just have x to the j. And this is a diagonal matrix. And so the way I want to think about this is that this will be weights, these x to the j's. Well, x to the j will weight the jth column with x to the j. This matrix here is all r by r minors are full rank. Right? This is just a Vandermonde matrix. Right? So at this point, all I'm using the fact that this is an MDS code, so you can replace anything that you want there. Okay, so using this decomposition, we can understand what this determinant of E restricted to S is. Right, so the determinant of E of X restricted to S is just something non-zero. This is sort of the gamma part, times X to the summation of I and S of I. Right, these are the weights. Okay, and so what happens when you do this exponential sum, you get that a determinant of E of xm is a big summation of something non-zero times x to the I and s of I. And what I'm going to do is that we have this determinant of m restricted to the s part. The problem is that m is sort of adversarial. Like, we don't know what m is. And that's sort of a problem. And so what I'm going to do is sort of a cheat. not really cheat, but I'm basically going to restrict to the summation where the determinant of MNS is non-zero. And in those cases where it's non-zero, I'm just going to absorb the non-zero part into the non-zero part. And so now what we need to understand is, you know, is this thing non-zero? And I've certainly lost enough information that you could really not do anything with it unless there's really a no cancellation object. Okay. And right, so the lemma is that there's a unique maximizer to this object. Okay. So if you look at this maximization over the sets where the determinant of M restricted S is non-zero, and you look at the summation in the exponent, then there's a unique maximizer. Yes. And so what is the sketch of this? As Abhi said, it's the lexicographic first, lexicographic maximum. I guess I'd prefer to think about it in the sense that it's the greedy one. And basically what you would do is you look at this matrix M, and you just pick greedily columns from starting from the highest ones going down, preserving the fact that so you pick the greedy one with respect to M on S0 being full rank. So you just keep on picking, or I guess rows in this case, rows of M going from the bottom, so that you always maintain that the rows are linear independent. And you just, whenever you can pick one, you pick it. Okay? And that will give you some set, and it will be unique. The greedy algorithm is unique because,
that's
true. Yeah. Okay. But I guess the point was that the weights here are unique, that you're weighting the jth column with the jth thing, so it's unique weights. And then you can ask, you know, why is this actually a maximizer? And it's because it's a matroid. Okay. Right. So then, what does this exponential sum look like? Right. The exponential sum is basically the non-zero coefficient times this unique maximizer, you know, plus lower order terms. And this says that because these are lower order, there's unique maximizers, there's no cancellation. So as a polynomial, this is non-zero. Okay, and that gives you what you want. Okay, so this is saying that if you look at this Wronskian on any large enough set of points, you'll find one which does not lose anything. Okay, and that's good enough for many applications. But we really needed this like lossless condensing property. And so that requires further analysis. But this is the first part. You need to know that the determinant is a non-zero polynomial. OK. So I guess I might end a little bit early. But OK, so what did Venkat and Swastik do? There are two ideas that you need to push this analysis into the lossless case. Right. So the first there are two actual. Let's I guess atomize the tasks. Right. The first task is to divide by t minus r plus one. Right. To say that this analysis was always in the case where your output equals the rank bound. Right. But you could imagine that the output is larger, and that was sort of actually crucial for us. And so then you would divide by t minus r plus one. The second thing that you need to do is you need to understand the rank deficiency. To say that the total rank deficiency is you sum over everything is bounded by the degree bound. Okay. And that gives you this lossless property. Okay, I'm going to do the second one first because I think it's more interesting. Okay. So I'm going to kind of cop out a little bit and not prove everything. But the main idea is multiplicities. Right, because there's some polynomial here, the determinant, that's governing when things work and when things don't work. And we've just used the fact that a low-degree polynomial has few roots. But you could imagine that you use the fact that low-degree polynomials have few roots even with multiplicity. And it's not obvious that that would work, but it does. And so why does that work? So suppose that you have a matrix P. I'm just going to step back more generally for a bit. Suppose you have a matrix P which is an n by n matrix of univariates. Okay. We know that suppose you take P of alpha and you have that P of alpha has determinant 0. Right? What does that tell you about P of alpha? So alpha is a field element. Right? That implies that P of alpha has rank, say, strictly below n. Right? But then you can ask, what happens if P of alpha has, you know, the determinant has higher multiplicity? Right? Well, the lemma is that n minus the rank of P of alpha is bounded by the multiplicity of P at alpha, or determinant of P at alpha. Okay. And this is true for any matrix P of univariates. So it's not specific to this case. And basically, how do you show this? It's a bit technical. But basically, you understand the derivatives of this thing. And if you take a derivative, say, k times, there's some idea that it's going to be a summation of determinants where you've only modified k rows. Okay. And so the point is that if you have really large rank deficiency, if you only modify a few rows, you can't change the fact that this is a low rank matrix, that this is bounded, this is non-full, okay, because you've touched too few things. And then basically it says that you have a large summation of determinants which are all still zero, and so you get a zero determinant. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not sure I understand the statement. So P of X is a mean space of polynomials.
Yeah, so P of X is a matrix of polynomials.
Okay.
So
then you think if P of alpha.
So P of alpha.
You take an evaluation point alpha.
Yeah, you have a matrix of polynomials. You evaluate each of those polynomials at alpha. Now you get a matrix in your base field.
Okay.
It has some rank. So yeah, I mean, maybe I should have put it on the other side, but. Okay, so that's the proof of that actual claim is maybe a bit technical and unenlightening, but anyways. Okay, so now, but I think more conceptual. So now I want to deal with how do you deal with larger output size. The answer here now, in one word, is folding, like the folded Reed solving or something. So let's look at this thing. So let me comment briefly. So Avi, you asked, like, are there other linear maps in some sense? And I showed you, based on this analysis in the Cauchy-Binet, that any MDS thing will work, right? And in particular, you know, this multiplicity argument is still generic, right? Here is where I'll actually use something that will need the fact that we either have derivatives or that we have these gamma derivatives. Okay, and you'll see why. So the goal I want to. Okay. So what I showed so far is that if you have NR linear maps, like so, this proof said if you have NR linear maps, one of them will preserve the rank exactly. On any M. By understanding multiplicities, I can say, in fact, not just that one will preserve the rank entirely, but the sum of the rank deficiencies will be at most n times r. But now I want, but this was in the case where you're mapping, you know, n-dimensional space to r-dimensional space. And now I want to understand, what if you map to a larger ambient space, going from f of n to f to the t. And there you could hope maybe for less maps because you have more freedom in the output. Okay, and so pictorially, right, we have f to the n, we have f to the t, f to the r, this is what we did before. You want to preserve this rank exactly. And now I'm saying, suppose you have f to the n and you have a larger f to the t, you know, you have more freedom to make sure the rank is preserved because the output size is larger. And so there you could hope to divide by this factor t minus r plus 1. OK, I'm just going to erase this though. Okay, so in this setup, what do you have? You have an R by T matrix, And again, I'm just going to tell you what is the ijth entry here. Right, this is gamma to the I, alpha to the j. Okay. And so what's interesting here is that if you look at shifted intervals, something like this, each of size r, there's some self-similarity. Okay. Right, so this is the matrix M. And what is that self-similarity? In particular, so this matrix here, right, is the Wronskian, the t-th order Wronskian at alpha. But suppose I do the following. I look at a contiguous interval of rows starting at the ith row. So here's, I've taken the first I rows, I've forgotten about them. And then I look at the next r rows. Right, so this is an r by r matrix. And what is it? It turns out to be the Wronskian, the rth order Wronskian, at not at alpha, but at gamma to the I alpha. Okay. Yeah. Oh, times m. Sorry. Yes. Sorry. Right. So basically, I mean, you can do it on this side also. Just saying that, like, the t-th order Wronskian has within it many small order Wronskians. So, like, putting it informally, you know, the t-th order Wronskian at alpha embeds what? It embeds the r-th order Wronskian. Well, this is at alpha, but what are the evaluation points of the r-th order Wronskian? It's going to be at 1 alpha, gamma alpha, up to gamma to the t minus 1 plus r alpha. So you take this one Wronskian at t, and you've embedded all of these evaluations. And you can kind of see that that's why we're getting a t minus 1 plus r. Now, you have to be a little bit careful. So there's earlier this question of what are the alpha? And for this Wronskian here, it really doesn't, you can take any alpha, any set. Here, it'll really be important that you actually, the alpha that you pick are in geometric progression of gamma. And why is that? Well, what happens? Well, what I want to do is I want to look at what are the evaluations of the t-th order Wronskian I'm going to pick. I'm going to pick 1 gamma squared up to gamma to the n times r. Right? Why? Well, what I proved over here, we know that this is a lossless condenser. Okay. And I want to say that I want to capture all of these things. Sorry, this is r. Yeah, so these are the alpha. So I'm going to take S to be this for the rth order Wronskian. And based on that, we know that this works. And if you look up to, say, gamma to the r minus 1 or something, if you take all of these first r evaluations, we know that in here, that this embeds into the rth order Wronskian just at alpha. And so what you do is you pick the set to be 1 gamma to the t minus 1 plus r, t minus r plus 1, gamma to the t minus r plus 1 squared, up to gamma to the n over r, to the so basically, you first start with a plain geometric progression in gamma. And now you take a geometric progression in gamma to the t minus 1 plus r. And because the t-th order Wronskian embeds all of these evaluations, you basically get all of these evaluations for free. Okay, and so now you can just take many fewer, and this gives you what you want. Okay, and so let me just, that basically completes the construction, modulo minor verifications. But let me just like recap to tell you what we really did. All right, so this gives you, right, we wanted an R and R like lossless rank condenser. All right, so this is saying it's a collection of maps. Right. Over R. Yeah, N. So I'm going to work through it. Right. So this is the lossless case. So I guess I was hoping to tell you these concepts and then leave the rest to homework or something. But basically, the point was that why does it help? Okay, so let me tell you why we got dimension expanders. Is that
right? No, he's asking about this. I mean,
why?
Okay. Yeah, so okay. So the first idea to improve on what I did here was to use multiplicities and say that the sum of the ranked efficiencies is bounded. And so to do this, I mean, sort of inherently sort of saying we're also again using multiplicities, but updated with the fact that we're using these fewer evaluations. So there's two ideas here. Yeah, so a bit, so this is the proof of what they did. So they had two ideas. The first idea was divide by t minus r, which is sparsification of this geometric regression. The second idea is understanding ranked multiplicity. You do that via multiplicities, and then you put them together, and this is what you get. Yeah, so you need, right. So what was we crucially used? Before I showed you that any MDS code worked, what you need now is basically that you have an MDS code such that whenever you look at intervals, consecutive rows of these MDS code, you still have an MDS code. Okay, that was like, that's this folding trick.
Okay. That's
and that's how gamma is used. So I don't know of other examples of MDS codes that have this part. Sorry? If you use the gamma stuff, it's, I think, all multiplicities that you get. I think it's just all multiplicities. So did you actually show that. Right. So I presented this one because this is the one I understand more. There, I think you look at the matrix and you say. You do more with multiplicities. I guess I don't remember more than that to say adequately. Oh, okay, I'll think about it later. I knew at one point. But. Okay, so you put these two ideas together. You take this degree bound, right? You can divide by t minus r, and then you can show the degree bound also bounds multiplicities. And I'll just remind you why I gave this talk. It's about dimension expanders to some extent. So we have this lossless object, and then you use averaging to get a lossy object. This r comma epsilon lossy condenser, which says that you're never going to lose more than epsilon r of your rank. And how many maps do you need? You just need this rank efficiency bound divided by your rank loss. So the number of maps is nr over t minus r plus 1. Epsilon r plus 1. Okay. And so the observation is that suppose that r is something like n over 2 and t is something like 2r. Right? Then in this case, you have this is O of n. O of r. Well, I mean, it's all O of n. Sorry, this is n divided by 2. So suppose that. Yeah, suppose the rank is n over 2. Suppose t, the output size, is twice the rank. I mean, this is order r, which is order n in this setup. Here is also order n. So the bottom is order n squared. The top is order n squared. So this is order 1. All right, so what this is saying is that if you're allowing me to lose a little bit, then I can actually condense rank in a constant number of maps. And this is actually known in the Boolean case also. I think, Ron, you have a result on this about a condenser that if you have constant min-entropy, you can use a constant number of maps to condense things. So there's like analogs there. But the point is that in this case, you can condense with a constant number of maps. And how do we use this to get dimension expanders? Well, you have this diagram. You start with a rank R subspace in Fn. You use, say, 10 maps to get a rank 10n. And then you want to sort of condense back down. This is tensoring. And you get back to Fn. And say you lose, you know, half of your rank. And you go to, say, 5 times R. And the number of maps here will be, this will be constant. And then you get, you know, some constant number of maps. And in this case, you can actually get like 400. But that's not much. OK.